Hello, my name is Denny Nolan and I'm the Director of Chassis Sim Technologies. And welcome to this latest episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. And today, ladies and gentlemen, I've got a real treat for you. What we're going to be talking about today is incorporating drivability into lap time simulation. And we're going to be revisiting this very important topic because about a couple of years ago, I first introduced you to this topic and how it was implemented into Chassis Sim. But over the last couple of days, I've been having some very, very good discussions with some colleagues of mine. And we were talking about this very, very same thing. And some really good things came as a result of that discussion. And I'm really looking forward to sharing that with you. Okay, so like last time, we're going to talk about the concept of the stability index. And I'm going to show you how this varies against grip. Then I'm going to show you how to incorporate this into Chassis Sim, but this time around I'm going to come at it from a different point in the compass. In particular, how you can specify this from scratch when you either haven't run the car before or you've only got a rough idea about what the car is doing, but you want to be really specific about how you incorporate the handling. If that is your cup of tea, ladies and gentlemen, this is the video for you. Now, we need to go through and do a little bit of revision. Now, my apologies for the viewers on the Chassis Sim YouTube channel who are familiar with the concept of stability index. I need to review this so that the newer viewers know what I'm actually talking about. What the stability index measures is it effectively measures the moment arm between the center of the lateral forces, which is often referred to as the neutral point, and it's that distance between the center of the lateral forces, and that point is called the neutral point, and the static the distance between that and the center of gravity. That is called the static margin, ladies and gentlemen. If you want the money shot about what truly drives race car stability, it's this little puppy right here. Don't get me wrong, the better your driver is, you can start to really lean on your steering sensor, the better they are. But the thing about it is, the worse the driver is, the steering trace can sort of leave you up the garden path. I'm not saying don't ignore it, quite to the contrary. I think a steering sensor is one of the most essential sensors you'll ever have in a race car. That being said, when you have a driver coming in talking about understeer and oversteer, this is the thing that's driving it. So that's a really, really key concept. And effectively what the stability index is, it's effectively this moment arm normalized by wheelbase. So, rough rules of thumb, what does all this mean? Less than zero, the car is stable. If you give it an input, it will it's not going to spin, it'll return to steady state conditions. If it's zero, if you give it an input, it's just going to keep on going. If it's greater than zero, you turn the steering wheel, it's going to swap ends, and when the driver comes back in the pit lane, they will be referring to you in extremely negative terms. Now, the whole idea with the stability index, the better your driver, the less stability index they can tolerate. A very, very key thing to understand. Now, good rough rules of thumb on stability index, you start at about minus 0.05 for a really good driver, but for your so-so drivers, you go to about minus 0.1. For your Aunt Maud's driving Miss Daisies, you've got to go to about minus 0.15 because they need that extra stability so they don't freak themselves out. Also, too, some rough rules of thumb, particularly when you're looking at the stability index trace and chassis sim, you can tolerate the odd excursion plus 0.1, but where you really want to concentrate your attention is in the mid-corner condition. Okay, what does the stability index look like during a corner? So, as we can see, we've got two changes here. The color change is an F3 car in standard format. The black is with that F3 car with the aero balance moved forward by 5%. So, as you can see, and this is part of the trick of looking at simulated data, you take a look at the steering trace here. Yeah, you've got some minor changes in the steering trace. Now, that boils down to the fact that Chassis Sim is the Terminator. But the big difference is down here, which is the stability index. In particular, take a look at that number. Mid-corner, the baseline was minus 8.7%. With that 5% change, that's minus 5.2%. So that is something that's a really big change. The driver is going to come in and tell you, wow, that was really, really different. But that shows you how it, during a corner. Okay, so incorporating this in the chassis sim. Now, here's where we're going to take a little bit of a different tack. One of the things that I said in my first video about incorporating drivability into lap time simulation was to find a setup that your driver was really, really comfortable with and they really synced with. You would then go through and click on the inertial property box, click on this driver stability settings, load in your car file, the curvature file, bump profile, and your circuit model. Click on OK, and it would generate this map. Now, here's the money shot, and this is really what I wanted to share with you, what I've been discussing with a couple of colleagues. This map, you don't have to wait to generate. You can generate this yourself. So you don't necessarily have to wait for good data. What you can do is that you can really fine-tune what the car is going to do by playing with what this map is. Let me show you how you do that. So, if we go to Chassis Sim, and we click on our inertial properties, which we can do either through our tree structure here, or by clicking on the roof or cockpit of the car, depending on the car skin that you have. If you go down here to driver stability settings, now, the key thing here, you can go straight to the stability index correction map. So this brings up a blank stability index correction map. So if you're going to do this from scratch, to really drive car behavior, what you can do is if you go to the axis properties calculator, you can put your minimum stability index. So we'll start from negative where the car is understeering like a pig. So we might say go to say minus 30%. And max stability index, we can go to 10. Now, here we want to incorporate our speed bound. So as a rough rule of thumb, I would go from 0 to about 360. Now, obviously, this is going to depend on the sort of car that you have, but 360 is probably not a bad thing to start. So if you click on that, that brings that. Now, this multiplier in here, what this is going to do is when Chassis Sim is solving for the mid-corner condition, it's figuring out what the raw stability index. The way this works is that when this map is active, it cross-references to the values in this map as a percentage to multiply by the apex cornering speed is going to be. So as an example, if I set this to 100%, 100%, 100%, and 100%, I'm going to show you guys a little Chassis Sim shortcut. If you press on the shift key, press on the right arrow key and go on the left arrow key, keep the shift key going down, notice how it highlights all the points. If you hit the L key to linearize, that linearizes all the points. Now, for this particular map right now, regardless of the stability index, the cornering value will be multiplied by 100%. So that's pretty much Chassis Sim as is. So let's just say, right, that what we want to do is say at minus 10%, this is the sweet spot for our driver. If he is driving a car with a stability index of minus 10%, he's as happy as Larry. So what we'll do is we'll leave that 100% as is. So what we'll do, and then let's just say that you've got a driver who abhors oversteer, but can put up with a bit of understeer. So typically, what you would do here is that you would drop this at a factor of, say, 0.5. So let's just say we could go down here to 90%. 90% for that. Again, we'll use our linearization trick. Now, let's just say that our driver absolutely abhors oversteer. So let's just say we can go to our 10% factor here and put in, say, 70%. And so we'll put on L. So what you've just done, ladies and gentlemen, is that you've created a really, really, really simple stability index map that when the stability index comes in at 10%, the cornering, if you've set up your car with a stability index of minus 10%, when it goes through, it sees that value of that map, it'll multiply by 100%. But anything that drops either side of that is going to heavily penalize that. So if we click on OK here, and then click here to enable the VX correction map, this is now going to have a very, very significant impact into the apex cornering calculation speeds and chassis sim. So you can use this information, ladies and gentlemen, and you can use this table to drive the setup. And so consequently, the way that you would do that going from driver to driver is if you were, say, dealing with, say, someone of the quality of, say, a Michael Schumacher, an Ayrton Senna, a Jim Clark, Max Verstappen, Lewis Hamilton, you would probably be going for stability indexes of about minus six percent for someone who's extremely good. -2%, that's basically God material. But if you're dealing with someone who's more of a gentleman driver, you'd be looking at about -14, -18%. And you can play with that to get the shape that you want. And also, too, you're not just limited to a straight line. I could probably go, say, to about, say, -6% in the high speed. Say, put that at 100. Put that at 100. Put that at 100. And then do also, and then keep that at 100. Maybe drop that down to about, say, 95. You know, to get the shape of the just to get that shape a little bit more to my liking, you could basically go through and dial that to the shape of what you want. But bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, and also too, the bigger you make these slopes, so the more this drop off, this starts to, you can pretty much dictate what the setup is going to look like purely from driving on this map. And that was, and during my discussion with my colleagues, that was something that really hit me straight between the eyeballs that I really wanted to share with all of you. And all you've got to do, go through that process, set it up with the axis property calculator as we discussed, and you're not limited to 11 points. You can get as weird and wacky as you want. I'd probably go, just for ease of editing, probably go to about 16 points to give yourself a little bit of flexibility. But this is a pretty good place to start. And then you can then click here to enable the stability index, and then this is going to drive your setup behavior. And that's a really, really important point. So, summing up. Okay, in an ideal world, what you do is that you go through the steps of my last tutorial, where you find a setup that the driver really likes, and let Chassis Sim fill in the blanks for you. Alternatively, you can go through the process we just discussed, where you just figure, okay, well, we're dealing with a driver. Do they like this map? Do they like that stability index map? Or I might have another driver who likes another stability index map. And that way you can really fine tune the results that Chassis Sim is going to deliver to the end of the lap time calculation purely based on the drivability of the vehicle. And that was one of the things, that was just one of those things, it was like, wow, I saw that moment and I figured, oh, that's very, very good. But again, just remember, this is a calculator, not a magic wand. Don't go silly. But don't take my word for it. Give it a go yourself, and we will catch you by using Chassis Sim Online, and we will catch you in the next Chassis Sim video tutorial or the next episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Course.